Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teach are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
So if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question.
Okay, so before we get to our brain teaser, we would like to let our viewers know that a little later in the show, Liz Gombert will be here from the Rochester chapter of Girl Develop It to talk to us about why it is important to have women in the coding and gaming industry.
And now, let's get to our brain teaser.
This person was born in Boston, Massachusetts in 1882. She graduated from Mount Holyoke College in 1902 and went on to get her master's degree in sociology from Columbia University, something that was very unheard of for women at that time. She saw firsthand how poor conditions in factories could lead to deaths. She saw this first in the 1911 Triangle Shirtwaist Fire that killed over 100 factory employees.
She went on to become the Industrial Commissioner of New York State, which put her in a position to help improve working conditions and related social issues. In 1929, she was selected by New York State's Governor Franklin Delano Roosevelt to become the state's Labor Commission. When FDR became president in 1933, he appointed this woman as the Secretary of Labor, making her the first female cabinet member. She played a key role in developing of minimum wages, Roosevelt's New Deal program, and Social Security.
So if you think you can solve the brain teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904. Or you could just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of this very show.
And every correct response is added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That is a tough question today.
It is. I'm just thinking those kids on there typing, looking up stuff on the internet.
All right. We're looking for some callers. All right, so we're ready for our first caller. I'm ready to do homework.
All right.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, who is this?
Hello?
Hi.
Hi, who's this?
Rhea.
Hi, Rhea. Make sure your television's turned down, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to go to the board and I'm going to help you with your math problem, okay?
Okay.
All right, what grade are you in?
Fifth grade.
All right, fifth grade math. Bring it on. I'm ready.
What?
What's your problem? What do you have to do?
It's 4 1/6 times 2.
Oh, we got to multiply fractions. Not only do we have to multiply fractions, one of those fractions is a mixed fraction, right? What's a mixed fraction, Rhea?
4 1/6.
4 1/6. And what does it mean when it's a mixed fraction? It means it's got a whole number and it's got a fraction with it, right?
Yeah.
Mixed numbers. So, any ideas? How are you solving these in class?
Well, you take the 2 and you put a 1 underneath it.
Okay, so we want to turn the number 2 into a fraction, because when you multiply fractions, it's easier when you multiply a fraction times a fraction. So the number 2, the whole number 2, is the same thing as 2 over 1, right? Because 2 divided by 1 is a number 2. All right, so now there's a couple other ways to deal with the 4 1/6. So I just want to know how you would start to go about it so I can help you the way that your teacher would help you in class.
Well, you multiply 4 and 6, which gets 24.
Okay,
so. And then you add the 1.
Great, so we're going to make it an improper fraction, right? So 4 times 6 is 24, and you add 1, and you get the number 25. Over the number 6, right? So what that means is 25 and a 6 is the exact same thing as 4 1/6. They're the same number, they're equivalent. So now it gets pretty simple from here. It's multiplying fractions. Do you remember the rule for multiplying fractions? We gotta multiply straight across, okay?
Okay.
So what's 25 times 2?
25 times 2?
Mm-hmm. Like, think about, like, if you had
50,
quarters. 50. You got it, 50. So 25 times 2 is 50. Okay, and now we're just going to multiply the bottom numbers together, okay? What's 6 times 1?
6.
6, okay. So we get the answer 50 over 6, right? So do you think we're done?
No, right?
Maybe. So we get 50 over 6 because it's an improper fraction. So we need to make this back into a mixed fraction, okay? So how are we going to go about doing that?
How many times does 6 go into 50?
Right, so let's put a little 50 here, and I'm going to do a little fraction thing, okay? I mean, a division thing. 6 goes into 50. What's the most we could get to it without going over?
6 times 8.
Great. And 6 times 8 is the number?
48.
Great. So we subtract those. And what's 50 take away 48?
What?
What's 50 take away 48? How many do we have left over?
2.
We have 2, right? So now what we're going to do is we're going to turn this into a fraction because 6 can't go into 2. So we're going to put the 2 on top over the 6. So we get 8 and 2, 6, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, but 8 and 2, 6 isn't good enough either. Psych. Because 2, 6 can be reduced, okay? So that's an even number. So 2 goes into the number 2 how many times?
Once.
And how many times does 2 go into the number 6?
3 times.
3 times. And our answer is 8 1/3. And now we actually are done. We finished the problem. Thanks for calling up, Rhea. That was a fun problem.
I said, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, this season, Homework Hotline has teamed up with the American Graduate Let's Make It Happen initiative to raise awareness about dropout issues, provide support to students, and connect young people with community resources related to learning both in and out of the classroom. Tonight for Women's History Month, we take a closer look at women in gaming and coding industry. Check it out.
I scheduled the meetup, I scheduled first class, and we got the traction right away.
The expression girl code has a different meaning for the members of Girl Development. The national nonprofit is working hard to close the gender gap in technology.
I always been, you know, kind of techie kid. I was, you know, one of those kids that plugs all the VHS at home and, you know, assembles computers.
Lena Levine founded the group's Buffalo chapter nearly 2 years ago. From beginner to advanced, its workshops are almost always sold out. The classes are in-depth, and Girl Development offers scholarships to help make them more affordable.
STEM like HTML, CSS, intro to the web concepts, intro to JavaScript, so all the basics that you need for pretty much any coding job.
We have had one lady get a job as a junior programmer, so.
Yeah.
More women are adding terms like coder and game developer to their resumes. Last year, women made up 22% of the game developer workforce. That was double the 11.5% of females in the field in 2009.
That says we've made progress, but we still have a long way to go, a very long way to go. Now, the number of women who actually play games is 50%.
Eloise Oizon has taught all things game design and development for the last 15 years at Rochester Institute of Technology. And every year, she makes it a point to try and encourage more female students to get in the game.
If we have women who come in, if we have people of color who come in and make games, they will make games that appeal to them, and that sort of broadens the conversation.
I didn't even know what technology was. No idea.
As a kid living in Colombia, South America, back in the 90s, Elizabeth Canis had zero exposure to computers and software. But through the years, technology as she knew it became less scary.
When I decided I needed to choose a career, I'm like, I'm going to be a programmer. What I thought programming was learning Microsoft Word, Microsoft Excel, PowerPoint. I would say I'm going to be an expert programmer in these programs. So my first programming class, I almost had a stroke.
Canis grew up in New York City, and she says back then, computer classes weren't a thing until high school, if you were lucky. Nowadays, she lives upstate and says when she hooked up with Girl Develop It, there was no turning back.
Number one, I learned that I was capable, because at a certain point, I felt that maybe I was too far behind and I was never going to be able to catch up, and perhaps technology wasn't going to be a career path for me.
There's a massive video game archive at Rochester's Strong Museum. In fact, it's the world's largest collection.
Some of the most compelling, interesting games now, a movement called indie games, many of those developers are women who are working on those as well. And it's a fresh voice and a sign of a maturing industry.
Oizan remembers a time when breaking into the industry as a woman felt impossible. She says those barriers helped her develop a tough skin.
The first woman in the situation, the first brown person in this situation, and all of a sudden you have to be not just competent, you have to be more than competent, you have to be super adjective, it is in that context, because you're representing everybody else.
Time to get some work done.
The women of Girl Develop It say they have more classes on coding, gaming, and mobile apps in the works, and they're pumped about hosting a second hackathon in the spring. But more than anything, the group is optimistic and say women will eventually reach parity with men when it comes to technology.
I think so. I think it's just we started later because we didn't have interest earlier.
And now we would like to welcome Liz from Girl Develop to our show. Hi, Liz.
Hi.
Thanks for coming.
Nice to meet you. It's a pleasure.
Thanks for coming. Yeah. We're so excited about this.
So what is Girl Develop It?
Girl Develop It is a nonprofit organization for women over 18 years old, teaching them and empowering them how to learn how to make software development or code or games like we've been talking about.
Okay.
So this video is talking about these people doing gaming and coding. What is gaming and coding?
Coding is what makes it possible to create computer software, applications, mobile apps. If anyone at home has played Candy Crush on their
sure.
phone, or if you use Google, that is all based off of code.
Okay.
I know a lot of students these days love PlayStation, Xbox, Wii U. That's also used with coding to create it.
Okay.
I like to give the example that code is a tool that developers use to build websites, such as a carpenter uses nails, wood, and paint to build a doghouse.
All right. In the video, we're hearing about this thing, a hackathon. What is that?
Hackathons typically last over a weekend or over several weeks. Basically, it's a large gathering of individuals that are interested in coding. There's software developers, designers, program managers, and they come and create, I like to call it, an invention marathon.
So they're not hacking into stuff,
No,
they
take about 3 days to create an innovative product, and then at the end of the 3 days is a judging panel, and there was actually one recently this past weekend in Rochester that our leader, Kristen Kurtzy, went to, and she was a judge at Brick Hacks at RIT.
Very cool.
Oh, totally cool.
Yeah.
So this organization, why is it important that there are organizations like this?
For our organization particularly, we want to definitely empower our women over 18 and create a judgment-free zone. Also, definitely to provide these women an experience where it's affordable for them if they missed the boat, or maybe they didn't have the opportunity when they were in middle school or high school or college to take these coding classes. Now we provide classes for them at any age to come and join us, compared to students today that could take a coding class.
Grew up taking coding.
Yeah.
So. They didn't have coding when I was in school.
Right.
Ours was let X equal. And
yeah.
So now, is this a local? Is it state? Is it national?
We're actually located in 53 cities. We're technically international. High five to Ottawa, Canada, being our one Canada city. But yeah, we're looking and growing every year.
All right, good.
Awesome.
Yeah, it is.
So gaming and coding, so this your program is for women. So why is it important that we get women involved in this?
Like the video said, women do play 50% of games out there. And so we definitely bring a different perspective and a different personality. And when you have more diverse groups involved in creating a product, you will always get a better result.
So right now, most people are not women. The majority of people who are coders are men who are doing coding?
Yes, yes. So if a student takes a field trip to a local tech company, basically they would notice that if they walked around, they would see maybe one woman out of the whole company being into the tech field.
Okay.
So Girl Develop It is here to provide an opportunity for us to grow more role models and inspire more the younger generations to get into gaming and coding.
So is that kind of what you meant when you said non-judgmental?
Right. Non-judgmental, empowering women, and making sure, you know, it is definitely affordable, like I said, so you don't necessarily have to go to back to college to take these classes. A lot of our students are self-taught and become successful.
All right. Wow. So how can we get high school and elementary girls more interested in gaming and coding?
That's a great question. I'd say definitely go talk to your counselor and see what classes are offered. But I also definitely encourage the schools to reach out to young women and women professionals that are in the field to have a optional lecture after school, or maybe even do a after school program geared towards girls in coding.
Cool.
So why do you think girls are getting this message that coding's for boys, or why is it so drawn to the boys, and why are the girls not saying, oh my God, I want to do that? Because I think of my students, I think they really want to do it, but then when they start getting up to college, they're like, nah, I don't want to do that. What's going on? What kind of messages are these girls getting? What stereotypes are they seeing?
Definitely for me, from my perspective, when I went through school and college, I was the only girl in the classes. Mm-hmm. And when I took, like I was mentioning earlier, these field trips to the tech field, I wouldn't notice any women in working with the men in there. So I think that is one stereotype that we internally automatically assume that is not the job for us. Mm-hmm. Also, compared to if you go to a hospital, you'll see plenty of nurses and doctors that are women.
Mm-hmm.
So we are trying to break down this stereotype and encourage more women who are over 18 to come and empower the younger women and start a new cycle.
Nice.
Awesome.
All right, so what do you want women to walk away with from when they take one of your guys' classes?
It's a safe environment. It's we want to empower you. You can always learn something new. Mm-hmm. And especially for the Rochester chapter here, mm-hmm. we would love for you guys to come to us and let us know if there's any classes that you'd like to see. At the Rochester chapter, we do all our classes and our meetups through meetup.com.
Uh-huh.
So you can go there. It's meetup.com, Girl Develop It, Rochester, New York.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And you can just shoot us an email and IM and be like, hey, I'd love to learn this. I love to learn HTML, CSS. I love to learn JavaScript or jQuery.
Right.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, wow. So thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, it was a pleasure, guys. Thank you.
So if you guys would like to learn more about Girl Develop It, head to our website, homeworkhotline.org. Stay right there. We're going to be back in a second. I said,
hey. How do you know which century you live in? The 21st century is the 2000s. The 20th century is the 1900s. The 19th century is the 1800s. The 18th century is the 1700s, 17th century is the 1600s, and so on.
I'm going to go back to doing some coding.
Go check out Girl Develop It.
I used to do it a long time ago. I'm really excited about it.
All right, so we got Brianna online. Hi, Brianna.
Hello.
You got a math problem. Is that true?
Yep.
I got it. I'm on the board, and we're going to work it with you, all right?
Okay.
All right, come on with me. All right, so I kind of shortened things up, but I'm going to read, and you tell me if this is right. We got a 7th grade class of 35 students went to an amusement park. Each student received 2 sandwiches, an apple, and a medium drink. An apple cost $1.25. A drink cost $3. The total for all the students is $306.25. We have to write an equation representing what took place at with this, and we're gonna let S represent. So S represents the sandwiches, right? For each, or the price for each sandwich. And we have to solve this equation, okay? Is that what we're gonna be doing?
Yeah.
All right, so we've read through this already, and I'm gonna go through and we're gonna highlight some important stuff. We've got each person got a sandwich, an apple, and a drink, right? And then we have some costs here. We have an apple. Oh, we have 2 sandwiches right here. Let me go back and make sure that we got 2 sandwiches. And then we've got an apple costs $1.25 and a drink costs $3. And our total is $306.25, but I don't know what the sandwiches cost, right? So when I was thinking about this, I'm going to write exactly what I know here, right? So I'm going to write 2, and I'm going to let S be sandwiches, right? So each student got that. They got one apple, and I'm going to write A, and we'll plug in what we got, right? One apple. And then they got one drink. Okay. And but this is just one person, right? And so when all together, we had 35 of these people going to the amusement park, right?
Yeah.
So that means I have to take this and put it in parentheses and multiply that by 35. Okay?
Okay.
And then we know that this whole total ends up to be $306.25. All right?
Yeah.
So that was just reading the equation and reading the what information they got. So now we have written our equation, right? It's not really the greatest one, but it's good, right?
Yeah.
So now let's plug in some numbers for what we actually know, okay?
Okay.
So I'm going to change color. I'm going to say, okay, I have 35 students. I have two, they get two sandwiches, which I still don't know, but I do know how much the apples were. And the apples were $1.25, and each one got a soft drink, and the soft drinks were $3. And that all totals to be $306.25, okay?
Okay.
So now we've done that part. Now we can go ahead and we can start solving and distributing, right? We have to get rid of the parentheses. So to do that, you and I both know we're going to distribute the 35 into each of these values all the way across, right? So when I do this, 35 times 2 gives me how much?
35 times 2?
Yep.
Can I use my calculator?
I just did right here. Can you see on the TV? I got right there. 70S, right? So I have 70S because I had 70 sandwiches, and I'm going to do $1.25 times 35. So I go 1.25 times 35, and I get $43.75. So I get plus 43.75. And then I'm going to do $3 times 35. Gives me $105. And that's all equals $306.25. Okay?
Okay.
I can combine these two together right here. If I do this, I can do this in my head. I get 143 plus 105 gives me 148.75 equals 306.25 plus my 70S. Okay. Now I need to get the 70S by itself, so I have to subtract minus 148.75. I got to subtract also here. I'm going to subtract minus 148.75. I'm going to bring my calculator down here so I can do this. All right. So I got 306.25 minus 148.75 equals, gives me 157.5. And that's equal to 70S. All right.
I'm just trying to write this all down.
All right, well, it's all right here for us. Now I got to get the 70 separated. I have to divide by 70. So I'm going to divide by 70. I'm going to divide this by 70. I'm going to extend my page here. And since I already have that in the calculator, I'm going to go divide by 70 equals. So now I've just found out that when I divide 70 by 70, this goes to 1. I get sandwiches equals, bring my calculator down so I can see my number, which is $2.25. All right, Brianna, there was a lot of work there. If I wanted to check, I would plug the 225 back into the equation that we had here, right here, and we should get $306.25. If you still need some clarification, you call Dial a Teacher and they'll run through it again with you. Okay, all right, is that all right? Thanks, Brianna.
All right, so we have a winner in tonight's brain teaser.
All right.
Who is this? Hello? Where's the applause?
Hi.
Hi, who is this?
Bader.
Hi, Bader.
So what's the answer to our brain teaser tonight? There's our applause.
Yeah, it is.
What's the answer, Bader, to the this really tricky brain teaser?
Francis Perkins,
it is. You're
so now, were
right.
You like typing in clues, or did you know this person or learn about this person?
That she was the first cabinet commissioner.
Sure, mm-hmm. And you knew this, or did you have to look it up?
I had to look it up.
All right.
I love it when someone's learning it in class that day, and they're like, "Oh my God, my teacher just talked about it today." So you did a great job. Thanks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, congratulations, Bader, and don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
So that's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
And tomorrow, our friends from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here again tomorrow with our science challenge. Good night.
Good night.
Tonight's Homework Hotline is part of American Graduate, a partnership with the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, with additional support from Newman's Own Foundation.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future, NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.